The Artist in Me, written by Shane Peacock, illustrated by Sophie Casson. The Artist in Me. In the beautiful countryside in southern France, near the town in Arles, long ago, I used to do an ugly thing. I tormented someone. I was mean to him. But he wasn't just anyone. He was a crazy man. He had wild red hair and a short red beard and a dream. His dream, he told anyone who would listen, was to tell the truth by painting pictures. That made me laugh, and I did it loudly. I made sure others heard me. Everyone I knew made fun of him. There were many reasons to laugh. He painted awful pictures. They had bright hues that didn't match. Colors weren't supposed to go like that. They pictured people who didn't look the way they ought to. And funny flowers, and shining streets, and strange starry skies. It wasn't right. But sometimes his art made me wonder. And if I saw him sitting alone at a cafe in Arles, staring off into the distance, I would walk nearby, because he sometimes propped his paintings against his table. I would make sure that no one was watching, and then steal long looks at what he had done. But I kept being mean to him. In crowds, of course, since that is what cowards do. "There goes the fool," adults would say. "A useless fool." I'd laugh with them. There was proof that we were right. No one ever bought his art. He was very poor. That was not to be admired. We called him horrible names. We threw things at him. It made us almost giddy. At times, he scowled at us. Other times, he didn't care. He kept painting. He painted every day, all the time, no matter the weather, or how he was feeling, or what we did or said to him. "I must tell the truth," he would keep repeating. He was on a mission. I wondered what my mission was. "But he's crazy," I reminded myself. Then, one day, I saw him near a roadway far out in the countryside. I was alone, chasing something, a rabbit perhaps, and came upon him suddenly. He was sitting before his easel with his back to me, staring out over a wheat field, and crows were approaching. It seemed he hadn't seen or heard me, though I was very close to him. I should have heard him breathing, but he made no sound at all. I knew that if I moved, made so much as a tiny noise, he would turn and see me. Me, who had been so mean to him. I was terrified. My knees went weak. My eyes widened. I almost fell over. And for an instant, the world was bigger and brighter than it had ever been. I stared out at the landscape before him. The sky was blue, but boiling with violet. The wheat field was brown, but shimmered like gold. Everything swayed and didn't seem exactly as it should. Or maybe it did. Somehow, he sensed I was there. He turned and looked at me. His face was glowing. It was like the pictures I had seen of saints in churches. He knew I was frightened. He smiled. He stood up and walked toward me. I shrank back. He reached out, and he offered me his painting. "Go on," he said kindly. "Take it." I refused, of course. I plucked up my courage and ran. Many years later, when I was growing old, I saw that painting one more time, hanging in a famous museum in Paris. It is one of his many masterpieces, a treasure no money can buy. I don't laugh at him anymore.